Welcome everyone to this week's episode of Unrooted Baseball Edition, and my guest for this week's show is none other than senior catcher on the baseball team here at Menlo College, Wyatt Nebe. Wyatt, thanks so much for joining me on the show.
Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome. Let's start by talking a little bit about yourself. Now, at various times over the summer, I saw you sporting some Neptune Beach Pearl gear. Were you a coach for the youth camps out there? And if so, what was your summer like?
So I actually get a ton of questions about that hat because I remember seeing you out there. We were running a Nike camp at the time.
Okay.
But it's West Michigan Whitecaps hat.
Okay.
And I looked up Neptune Beach Pearl after you said that, and they look fairly similar. They look almost like the same hat. But no, my brother got me that for Christmas. I got a bunch of minor league hats, and I love them. They're just random teams. I just got one the other day. And I love wearing them, and they're cool hats. So
what is
definitely
your
not the Pearl.
What is your favorite minor league hat that you have?
The one I just got, the Amarillo Sod Poodles.
Yes, brand new team down there. Yeah,
for the Double A for the Padres.
Yeah,
and I don't know where Sod Poodle even came from because I started Googling it and nothing was coming up. It was saying maybe a prairie dog, but what's on the hat, it looks like an armadillo head. So I don't know what they're going for.
It really is crazy how all of these minor league teams are now like changing their previous identity to become something completely outlandish and just random. Like they're going to be 2020 A-level with the Angels, the Rocket City Trash Pandas. If you haven't seen them, they're actually on Twitter. Not trying to endorse them or anything, but seriously, the logo is like a panda riding inside a trash can.
I'll have to look that one up.
It's fantastically weird.
But see, that's the fun part. It's like no one knows who it is, so then they got to ask you questions about it. It's not a major league team, because I'm a Yankees fan, and I don't want to wear anything but Yankees. But if it's a minor league, no one really knows what it
exactly.
is.
Exactly. Minor league's completely
They have so many different names, so many different cities, and it's just fun to kind of research them a little bit and see where they're from.
Yeah, look up the Trash Pandas. I don't know what you'll find, but you can at least find their Twitter, that's for sure. Now, don't ask me how I got this information. I think it was on Unrooted last season, but somehow on my note sheet for you, next to your name, I have, in parentheses, good at calf roping. I don't know if that means you're actually good or not, or maybe it's because your nickname is the sheriff or what, but might you actually be good at the rodeo?
You know, I wish I was. My dad grew up in that life, and I grew up a little bit in it. I was part of the Reno Rodeo for mutton busting for 2 years. I actually won my last year for it. I think I was 5 that year, but I did 4 and 5, and I kind of wish I would have continued it, but baseball went the route, and I would love going back to that life, honestly.
This is just a completely happy accident that I asked him this because I had no idea that you actually had the rodeo genes in your family.
My dad rode all the way up till college, I think 1 or 2 years in college before the UNR program went down, and then he had a chance to go to Fresno State for it, but he decided against it. And then on my mom's side, her uncle was the president of the Reno Rodeo for 1 year, so I got it on both sides, but I'm definitely not good at calf roping.
Why have you ever tried?
I've tried. My dad got me one of those bullheads to stick on a hay bale. Couldn't hit it very well with the lasso. But I do, one of my good memories from being in the backyard with my dad is trying to run around the yard and run away from him. He's got the lasso, and he's trying to hook my legs and take me down with it.
But he's trying to Wyatt rope.
Yep. He's trying to latch one of the legs and trip me up, but I try to get away from him.
So if you had the opportunity to, I don't want to say start over, but at this point in your life, if you had the opportunity to just run away and like live on a ranch, on a farm, middle of nowhere, would you do it?
I would do it, yeah. I wouldn't know where to start. I'd probably need a lot of advice from my dad. He may
say,
even go
bring
out,
him,
He might even go out there with me because I know my family and I have talked about it, and I mean, everyone's down for it. All 6 of us are down to go out to Texas somewhere, start a ranch. I mean, have some fun out there. Just get a couple acres. Go have fun.
Call me when this happens because I'm definitely interested in this as well. All right, let's talk about the team here a little bit. Menlo started a conference play a few weekends ago with a 4-game series against Vanguard, now one of the ranked teams within the GSAC. First of all, what was it like getting your first taste of the brand new conference format where you're having to play back-to-back doubleheaders, so 4 games in, 36 hours?
Yeah, it's definitely a big change, adding another 7-inning game. It's a lot more tiring because, I mean, before we had one Friday and a long day Saturday, but now we got two long days back to back. So definitely got to stay healthy, get those fresh legs, and then stay mentally strong throughout the whole games. So it's a long weekend, but then the other big change is we only get to see the teams once now.
Yeah.
So we got to give it our all against them, and then hopefully see them back again in playoffs. So.
Now, there was a lot of turnover on the pitching staff this offseason, and certainly that brings a lot of new challenges for a catcher like yourself. How do you go about building relationships with every pitcher, especially ones who you aren't familiar with from the year before?
You're just honestly trying to spend as much time with them as you can, both on and off the field. That's the fun part about it, is you get to create bonds with them. They're definitely a different breed, but it's fun to talk to them, get to know them. We have Australia this year, we have Japan, Taiwan, we have all over the world and all over the country. So just to see different backgrounds and get to know the pitchers, get to know people and who they are as a person outside of the game too, that's the fun part. It's a challenge though, but it's fun as being a catcher, getting to know your pitchers, know what they want to do in certain situations, what they're comfortable with. But we had a bunch of turnover, and in the fall that's different because we're trying to catch as many guys as we can, get to know them right away so that we can know their pitches and everything. But it's been fun so far.
Now, you have a unique perspective on the game being a catcher. So who offensively is the toughest out, do you think? Who in your lineup, your starting nine, who gives opposing pitchers and opposing teams the most hits?
I would say Nick Adgar. I watched the last Unrooted, and Coach White was talking about it. He's definitely... And I've been with him the last 4 years. I was with him at College of San Mateo, too, and seeing him grow over these last 4 years, as Coach White was talking, he's seen him for 2 years. But just seeing who he is as a person and recognizing that and knowing what he can do as a hitter, I know he's had a ton of walks so far this year. I don't know how many, but he's changed his approach. He knows who he is as a hitter, and when he gets that mistake, he demolishes the ball, and it's been fun to see. So as a pitcher, I would definitely pitch around him, which is what they've been doing, and he's been getting on first base a lot.
And then when they miss, and they miss over the plate, he's destroying the baseball.
He takes care of it.
Oh, yeah. They average near 400, I'd say. He's off to a pretty good start. Now, you're back in conference play this weekend against Arizona Christian, a team that can hit the ball all over the yard. We saw that here in Atherton last season. What will it take to shut them down this weekend at home?
Just sticking with our game plan, honestly. Like you said, we have a lot of new pitchers, but we've added a lot of depth. And that's nice with the four-game set that we have that advantage and we're able to go to the next guy if we need to. But we also, we can hit on the other side. So we need to take care of that and take care of the situations that we've had where we haven't been getting runners in certain situations. We've left a lot of people on base, but the chances are there. And with those opportunities, we're going to get that knock and we're going to push runs across, and our pitching is going to do their job. So it's going to be a fun series this weekend.
For sure. And that's at Cartan Field, doubleheaders at 11 o'clock on both Friday and Saturday. All right, Wyatt, let's get into the final segment of the show. It's called Brownie Bites. I'm going to ask you three off-the-wall questions. Give me your best answers. Question number one, which teammate is most likely to drive a minivan?
I'm going to say Spencer. Currently, he has a Prius right now. And I think the next upgrade from that would be a minivan. So when he starts family, gets a little bigger, I think he's going to go to a minivan. And I could see him being a stay-at-home dad, driving to soccer practice. But right now, he's cool with the Prius. And I don't know, I could see him driving that minivan around.
When you began that answer, I was very confused how the Prius and the minivan would be related.
It's
but you explained
step.
It well.
Yeah.
You explained it well.
It's the next step.
He not only cares about the environment with the fact that he's driving a Prius now, but then he's going to care about his family,
exactly.
The safety of his family, getting them all from point A to point B in one trip. So I get it.
He's going
to
be the soccer dad, so he'll have fun with it. But yeah, the next step, he's got to grow from the Prius to the minivan.
Yeah.
He'll do it.
We got some time for that
he'll
still. We got some time.
I'll help him out with it.
How are you going to help him out?
Make sure that he buys the minivan.
Okay.
After this.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's coming up next on the next episode of Unrooted. Spencer Vincent buys a minivan.
Yeah.
Question number two, which teammate could eat the most oranges in 5 minutes?
Tyler Kennedy, for sure. Every time we go to Mongolian, him and I put down food, so I feel like he'd be able to put down oranges too. Because it's all you can eat buffet over there, mm-hmm. and him and I go back for at least three bowls so the kid can eat, but Tyler Kennedy would eat five or a lot of oranges in 5 minutes. I don't know how many. Yeah. I don't know how he would feel the next day, but he would put them down.
Well, who cares about how he would feel? I mean, at least it's something healthy like an orange.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I could have said, like, how many chicken nuggets could he eat in 5 minutes?
It'd still be Tyler Kennedy.
No matter what it was, yeah. It'd be Tyler Kennedy?
Uh-huh. He'd still put it down.
All right. And then question number three, which teammate would actually make the best sheriff?
Aside from me?
Yes. Don't count.
All right. Dylan Cole. And he's my roommate right now, and he's actually looking in to be a cop or a firefighter after this. So I feel like, I mean, he's going towards that dream right now. And if he becomes an actual sheriff one day, then I think he'll be a pretty good one and keep things in order.
Okay, good. Because I was going to say, you could actually, you know, trash talk him a little bit and say, like, oh, well, just because he's my roommate and he wants to be a cop doesn't mean he'd be a good one. But if you say so.
I think he'd be a good one. So.
He does have the size. He would kind of bring that intimidation factor a little bit because he is a pretty large man.
Yeah, he's a large man. He's a rule follower, too. So I think we need that on the streets.
Why not? Bring back the olden day sheriff.
I think he could wear the short shorts, too, little aviators. He can't grow a mustache very well, though, so that wouldn't come in.
Well, now you're sounding like 1980s movie cop as opposed to...
Oh, that'd be nice. Like Reno 911.
Yes, but that to me, that's not the sheriff, you know.
But he would change it.
He'd be a 1980s cop / western sheriff.
Absolutely.
Rolled into one.
Yeah. He'd bring back the Fed. He'd start it up again. It hasn't died yet, so.
The image inside my mind right now is I don't know if it's terrifying or if it's creepy. It's not very good.
That's all right.
It's not very good.
He'll send you pictures.
And all of these pregnant pauses at the end are not helping it at all. So I think we're going to end this thing. Wyatt, thanks for joining me on the show.
Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Folks, the baseball team, they're at home this weekend. 4-game series against Arizona Christian. It begins on Friday with a doubleheader at 11 o'clock. Then on Saturday, another doubleheader also at 11 o'clock before the Oaks. The following weekend, host Westmont College. We invite you to tune into next week's episode of Unrooted Baseball Edition when Wyatt Nebe will select the next interviewee by me, Brian Brownfield, right here on the show. Until then, we'll see you next time. Take care, everyone.